tempted with grief and shame weighed down. Now scornfully surrounded with thorns thy only crown. Oh, sacred head, what glory, what bliss till now was thine. Yet though despised and
Good evening. Great to be with you tonight on this fifth and final midweek service in the season of Lent. This coming Sunday begins Holy Week with Palm Sunday and Passion Sunday. And then we will continue our worship throughout Holy Week. It will start again on Holy Thursday at 6 o'clock, Good Friday at 6 o'clock, and then Easter morning. There are two opportunities for worship. There is a sunrise service at 7 a.m. That's in the morning time. And then there is at 9:30 a.m., our regular time of worship. Between that, there is a breakfast that you are all invited to join us for. And then if you are a child, you have children, grandchildren, or you're a child at heart, you can join us for the Easter egg hunt at 11 a.m. Everything that you need to follow along in worship is in the bulletin. It's also on the screens tonight. Let us rise, welcome those that we are worshiping with, and share the peace of Christ. Peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord. Peace of Christ. Peace of Christ. Peace of the Lord. Peace of Christ. Brothers and sisters, you may be seated for our opening hymn, hymn 560, Drawn to the Cross Which Thou Hast Blessed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will be glad and exult in you.
I will
the Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Let us make our confession to our God, seeking His grace and His forgiveness. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant you pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all of your sins. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, who gives strength to the weak and light to those who are in darkness, grant us to grow in grace and in the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ, that through him we may know you more completely. Assure us that all things are made to work for our good through our Savior, Jesus Christ, so that we may, with hopeful hearts, await the glory of his kingdom of eternal grace. With boldness and confidence, we ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for our responsive hymn, O Sacred Head Now Wounded.
The Old Testament lesson for this evening comes from the prophet Jeremiah, the 9th chapter. Who is the man so wise that he can understand this? To whom has the mouth of the Lord spoken that he may declare it? Why is the land ruined and laid waste like a wilderness so that no one passes through? And the Lord says, because they have forsaken my law that I set before them and have not obeyed my voice or walked in accord with it, but have stubbornly followed their own hearts and have gone after the Baals as their fathers taught them. Therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will feed this people with bitter food and give them poisonous water to drink. I will scatter them among the nations whom neither they nor their fathers have known, and I will send the sword after them until I have consumed them. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God. Blessed is the one who considers the poor.
In the day of trouble, the Lord delivers him.
The Lord protects him and keeps him alive. He is called blessed in the land.
You do not give him up to the will of his enemies.
The Lord sustains him on his sickbed, In his illness, you restore him to full health. My enemies say of me in malice, when will he die and his name perish?
And when one comes to see me, he utters the words, while his heart gathers iniquity. When he goes out, he tells it abroad.
All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. Even my close friend in whom I trusted, who ate my bread, has lifted his heel against me.
But you, O Lord, be gracious to me, and raise me up, that I may repay them.
By this I know that you delight in me. My enemy will not shout in triumph over me.
But you have held me because of my integrity, and set me in your presence forever.
Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The epistle comes from 2 Timothy, the third chapter. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness, but denying its power. Avoid such people, for among them are those who creep into the households and capture weak women, burdened with sins and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth, men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God. We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 26th chapter. When Jesus had finished all these sayings, he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days the Passover is coming, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Then the chief priests and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise
you may be seated for our hymn 428, Cross of Jesus, Cross of Sorrow. This is 432. Use your hymnal. This is 432. Pain the eternal sun. I knew that was not Cross of Jesus when it started. I don't know how that happened, but it is what it is. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Heavenly Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts, may they be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So we are continuing our theme on Be Gracious to Me as we're kind of working our way through Psalm chapter 41. And tonight we continue with David's prayer and we hear these words as he prays, "All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. They say, a deadly thing is poured out on him and he will not rise again from where he lies." In our everyday conversations, the term enemy might seem a bit overstated to our actual situation, and yet it's a term that we maybe use from time to time. Certainly the devil, the world, and our sinful nature, our enemies that oppose us with lethal intent. But those enemies are spiritual, right? They're not physical. They are not human. Not many of us truly have physical, look you in the eye enemies. We may have people that we don't like, people that don't like us, people that we have had spats with in the past, but to truly have an enemy, for most of us, it's not something that we perhaps experience. But David and Jesus definitely knew such enemies. Now, we have these people in our lives that, let's be honest, they're sitting there twiddling their thumbs, buying their time, waiting for us to die so that they can get our money. Not saying that they're children, they might be children, might be relatives, might be friends, right? These people that are just waiting for us, but they're likely not scheming to murder you, okay? They're just kind of waiting things out. But traitorous and murderous men did scheme against David. They imagine the worst for me. They say a deadly thing is poured out on him. In a similar fashion, Jesus endured deadly design and the cunning craftiness of murderers. We heard about that in the gospel lesson. The chief priests and the elders of the people, they plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and to kill him. Your situation and my situation is probably noticeably different. We do not, at least not yet, have people who directly seek our deaths. Our enemies, well, they're a lot less violent people who are usually just plain mean. They just say things that are unkind. They are people who speak evil about us, usually behind our backs, but they might even do it right to our face. They are people who even seem weirdly satisfied by our pain and our troubles in this life. They are people who selfishly take but refuse to give. They are people who willingly commit acts of injustice, and they just kind of leave us feeling awful. Usually awful about ourselves. And sometimes these people go so far as to make us feel as if life may not be worth actually living. There are people out there that have that effect. And the worst thing about such people is that they always seem to get away with it. Right? They always seem to get away with the behavior, with the unkind words, with the actions that follow. They're never called out. They're never reprimanded. They're never disciplined. But rest assured, brothers and sisters, they will not get away with it. David's enemies thought that they were going to get away with their injustices against him. They poured out for him a deadly thing, and then foolishly, very foolishly, they said, "He will not rise again from where he lies." But they could not have been more wrong. No one who dies ever stays dead. All people will rise. The scriptures say some to everlasting life and some to everlasting shame and contempt. Jesus spoke the truth that gives shape to all of eternity when he declared, "Truly, truly, I say to you that an hour is coming and is now here when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live." "Do not marvel at this," Jesus says, "for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment." These are the words of our Lord. And these words speak certainty about the resurrection. David lives in that certainty during his lifetime. Our Lord Jesus Christ embodies that certainty in his own life, death, and of course, resurrection. And you and I, we have been baptized into that certainty. Paul writes, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? If we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his." You see, fellow redeemed, the certainty of the resurrection allowed David to live in confidence, to live with a certain sense of hope, that even though his enemies said things about him like, "He will not rise again from where he lies," David knew full well that he would rise again. And that knowledge gave him comfort, and it gave him power even in the midst of those difficulties. David's faith in the resurrection indicates that no matter what he had to suffer, he knew that his suffering would not last. It was not forever. David's Psalms are full of resurrection hope, even when David himself is on the verge of flirting with death. Right? When David prays, I want to read some of the various psalms that David prays, and he brings up kind of this resurrection hope. He confidently prays, "I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around." Or later again in the Psalms, when he prays, "I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." Brothers and sisters, you and I can confidently pray those very same prayers. Relief from suffering is only the first comfort of the resurrection. There's a second comfort, and it's vindication. Vindication is when all the wrongs are made right. Vindication is when those who have suffered loss have their loss returned to them. Oh, vindication is a great thing. Have you ever suffered? Consider this question. Have you ever suffered some form of an injustice in life? And you're just waiting for some vindication. You are not alone. There are countless martyrs who have come before you who have lost their life and are waiting some vindication, and they cry aloud from the word of God, "O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge our blood?" All who whisper about me, they hate me, David prays. They imagine the worst for me. No doubt David, as a king, and really as a great commander of his army, knew that though his enemies may win a battle from time to time, they would never win the war. They would never win the war. David knew that with all confidence. He was certain and sure of his vindication. He prays it. "All my enemies shall be ashamed and greatly troubled. They shall turn back and be put to shame in but a moment." Or later in the Psalms when he prays, "By this I know that you, Lord, delight in me. My enemy will not shout in triumph over me, but you have set me in your presence forever." So how do we really know that David's enemies didn't get away with it? Maybe that question isn't as important as this one. The one that's more pointed and gets to the heart of the matter for us today. How do we know that our enemies are not going to get away with what they have done to us? We know these things because the enemies of Jesus could not and did not get away with their plans to kill him. The words of Psalm 41 are the words of Jesus, surely as he speaks them through the voice of King David. "All who hate me whisper together about me. They imagine the worst for me. They say a deadly thing is poured out on him. He will not rise again from where he lies." You see, the enemies of Jesus were so desperate that he not rise again from where he lies, that they actually went so far as to post a guard and impose a seal upon his tomb. The chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and they said, "Sir, we remember how that impostor said while he was still alive, 'After 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people that he has risen from the dead. And the last fraud will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can." So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard upon it. But the enemy's plan did not work, did it? No seal or soldier could keep our Lord in that tomb. Jesus rose from the dead, and the Father crowned him with glory and honor. Jesus was vindicated as he rose from the dead on that resurrection morn. And brothers and sisters, you too will be vindicated. The injustices and those who have committed them will not go unanswered forever. Those who have harmed you have truly only harmed themselves. You will gain back all that has been taken away. You will rise again where you are finally laid down. King David and all the other faithfully departed saints, they will be there with us as they too will rise from the dead in the power of Christ who rose before us all. And on that great day, we will say with David, and we will say with Jesus, and we will say with all the other faithfully departed saints, you have upheld me because of my integrity and set me in your presence forever. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. May God grant that unto us all. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, may it guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We rise for the litany. O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
hear us.
God the Father in heaven,
have mercy.
God the Son, Redeemer of the world,
have mercy.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy.
Be gracious to us. Be gracious to us from all sin, from all error, from all evil, from the crafts and the assaults of the devil, from sudden and evil death, from pestilence and famine, from war and bloodshed, from sedition and from rebellion, from lightning and tempest, from all calamity by fire and water, and from everlasting death. By the mystery of your holy incarnation, by your holy nativity, by your baptism, fasting, and temptation, by your agony and bloody sweat, by your cross and passion, by your precious death and burial, by your glorious resurrection and ascension, and by the coming of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. In all time of our tribulation, in all time of our prosperity, in the hour of death and in the day of judgment, we poor sinners implore you to rule and govern your holy Christian church, to preserve all pastors and ministers of your church in the true knowledge and understanding of your wholesome word, and to sustain them in holy living, to put an end to all schisms and causes of offense, to bring into the way of truth all who have erred and are deceived, to beat down Satan under our feet, to send faithful laborers into your harvest, and to accompany your word with your grace and spirit, to raise those who fall, and to strengthen those who stand, and to comfort and help the weak-hearted and the distressed. To give to all peoples concord and peace, to preserve our land from discord and strife, to give our country your protection in every time of need, to direct and defend our president and all in authority, to bless and protect our magistrates and all our people, to watch over and help all who are in danger, necessity, and tribulation, to protect and guide all who travel, to grant all women with child and all mothers with infant children increasing happiness in their blessings, to defend all orphans and widows and provide for them, to strengthen and keep all sick persons and young children, to free those in bondage, and to have mercy on us all. To forgive our enemies, persecutors, and slanderers, and to turn their hearts, to give and preserve for our use the kindly fruits of the earth, and graciously to hear our prayers. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. O Christ, O Lord, O Christ, O Lord. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In the closing stanza of My Song is Love Unknown, Samuel Crossman uses a special term for Jesus, whose ministry and suffering and sacrifice have been described in the previous stanzas. This is my friend, the author states confidently. In speaking with the disciples in the upper room on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus said, "Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you." Jesus commanded his disciples to love one another, reflecting the deep and amazing love which he was showing them then and would be fully demonstrating in the next hours of his passion. Jesus is our friend for a time and eternity, whose sweet praise we now sing. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day, and I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you now and always. Amen. You may be seated for our closing hymn, hymn 431, Not All the Blood of Beasts. Thank you. I announced at the beginning of worship the Holy Week schedule. If you still need that or are unsure, it is in the, I believe it was in the announcements, or it will be for sure this coming Sunday, and it was also in the newsletter, and there are still copies of that, I believe, in the back. One other announcement, I try to make this, and I usually forget, but the April portals of prayer are available. They're on the little table in the back. So if you would like that, make sure that you grab one of those. Go in peace, serve the Lord.